what all the money went for. And of course, it saved the board a lot of money because they didn't have to pay my travel. They would pay for Marion, but they'd have to pray for me. Anyway, got back to the United States. And interesting enough, Dr. Howard, they wanted me to get off the payroll of the board just as quickly as possible, you know. Well, we arrived in July, and by October, I was off the payroll. And I was assigned, or I volunteered, really, to serve the church at Franconia, New Hampshire.
Oh, really?
So I'm back home again. Here. I was up there the other day. The church is doing a little better than when I was there, but still church, same church.
Was it already a United Church?
Yes, it was already a United Church, Baptist Congregational. And I served there 2 years. And our daughter, Marty, was born in Littleton, which is a town next door. After 2 years there, it was decided that by the board, well, I, of course, pushed them a little bit, but it was decided by the board that it would be very good for me to take some advanced work. So I already had an M.A. in Oriental Religion and Philosophy.
Now, had you been ordained with that M.A., or no? You were unordained at that?
No, I'll get to that in a minute.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm
sorry. I went to Cornell for a full year, and it turned out that the material that I'd done at Hartford was enough to qualify me to become a PhD candidate. See, if I'd gone theology, I wouldn't have been, but I'd done these other things which were non-theological, and they managed to patch together enough credits that they could say I entered as an AM or MA student, you see. And I decided that after studying for a while that I wanted to do an in-depth study of the old people. These are the people with whom we had already served a little bit, and we intended to serve the rest of our lives if possible. So again, I had to argue a little bit with the powers that be, but Cornell is very generous about such things. They have opened their program to missionaries probably as well as most schools. Anyway, my senior professor there was Anderson, and he had been on that group in 36, 37 that went around the world to review missions, you remember? He'd been on that, so he's a keen missiologist. That was really wonderful for me. No prejudice against me, you know. So I did my first year at Cornell and then went back to Burma in the fall of 45. We couldn't get into Burma yet. There was no transportation. But I went as far as India. And for about 4 months, I spent my time buying army surplus stuff and shipping it all over India. Now, I didn't handle the money. The money was all handled through Delhi, and we had an office there. But I was the guy that had to go from these huge storehouses along the Lado Road and pick the stuff up. And if it was not already boxed, we had to box it, put it on the train, and ship it back into India for the use of very many mission societies. The government was very generous. They said that we will sell anything we have for 25% of its value. And I must have taken delivery of 30 vehicles, two entire air conditioning units for a hospital.
You said this was in 45.
45.
The war was still on.
Oh, not. They were beginning to dispose of things all. 45, 46.
Oh, yeah, 45, of course, was when the war ended, not 46, yeah.
45, 46.
Yeah.
Anyway, I spent about 4 months at that. So I got to know the roads of Assam very well, and I got to meet all of our missionaries up there, too. And I hauled a lot of stuff from them, too. It was a lot of stuff that was going gratis. And I managed to get a hold of a 6x6 truck. Do you know what they are?
Yeah.
Those great big jobs, 3.5 tonners. And whenever somebody would say, well, we're breaking up, they were breaking up the units, you know. And whenever any, and interesting enough, I got next to a chaplain who was Southern Baptist, a guy by the name of Schamberger. I've never seen him again since, but he had an empty bunk in his officer's quarters. So he took me in, let me sleep in his bunk. I went to the dining room and got my meals for about $1.25 a meal, you know, good American meals. And I wore khaki-colored clothing, you know. I looked just like a GI, and only I was in the officer's quarters. Schamberger, because I was eating with the officers, you know, I found out when every particular unit was going to break up. And I'd get my truck and drive over there, and any bottle of medicines that had even had 10 taken out of them, you know, that was considered as disposable. Well, I'd say, well, I know what to do with it. So I got bottles of medicines and GI shirts and trousers and mosquito netting and mosquito nets and all that kind of stuff. Just unbelievable amounts. Actually, Guwahati, our hospital at Guwahati and the one at Jorhat operated on stuff that I hauled them for about the next 10 years, they told me. You know,
sure.
For the general things, not the really difficult medicines, but that was another experience. Then at the end, I bought my own truck. This time it was a weapons carrier, because I was looking forward to using it in Burma, and I didn't want one of those 6x6s. One of those 6x6s, however, got into the hands of Herman Tegenfeldt, and they built that great big magnificent church at Michinaw using the truck that I had used to run around with, you know. I drove into Burma twice, and the first missionaries who were not attached to the army got into Burma because I took them there. That was Selma Maxfield and Alice Thayer. Alice Thayer was in Mandalay, and Selma Maxfield was from Maulmain. I'd known both of them well. They were just eager to get back in, you know. And when they found I was going to go, well, I said, all right, the two seats in the front truck. Of course, the truck didn't have any doors or anything else, and it had to hang on pretty tight, but we made it, and I delivered them to Mandalay. Well, of course, Selma Maxfield was later killed in the crossfire in the Maulmain area about a year later.
Between the British and the Burmese?
Was between fighting between the Burmese who backed the Japanese and the Burmese who were with the British. There was a lot of that going on.
I wasn't aware of that.
Yeah. Anyway, my truck was a weapons carrier. You probably will recall those. They were big Dodges that had a very high clearance and four-wheel drive and very powerful. I used to say they could climb a tree if you could find one in the right water bright enough to do it. They had tremendous power. And I attached a trailer, a ton trailer. Of course, with the way I loaded, it was a darn sight more than that. But I drove then from...
You carried all the gas you needed to drive the thing.
That's right. I had two drums of gas, 55-gallon drums. I worked my way from India to North Burma over the Lado Road, and then down and, well, zigzag path, 1,700 miles from India to my station, which was Taungji. I had already driven those roads before because I'd driven for the ambulance for Seagrave, you know, so I knew the territory very well.
And 2 55-gallon drums of gasoline took you 1,700 miles.
Yeah.
You got better mileage than I thought.
Yeah, I did very well. I did very well. Anyway, got to Town G, and of course, my wife had been, and children were left behind because we didn't know what kind of situation we were getting into in Burma.
Left behind in the States?
In the USA, yes. And they wanted me to go out there and look at the buildings and see what was available and all that kind of stuff before I brought two children. You see, we had two children by then. And actually, it wasn't as bad as I thought, but I did have to rebuild a house for ourselves. All the Japanese had chosen our mission buildings for their headquarters. As a result, when the American bombers came through, you know, they plastered them. So practically all the buildings were destroyed that we owned. Well, one of them had apparently a small bomb had hit just the roof and blown the roof off. So I re-roofed that one, and of course there's a lot of shrapnel and not much glass that was in the windows, but it was livable. And Marion joined me about 15 months later, in early 47. Well, the Poles were very happy to see us back. Of course, with the war, a lot of them had kind of...
And you're saying Poe.
Pa-O. There's another group called Poe, P-W-O.
Okay.
They're Karens. And the Pa-O and the Poe are very closely related, and the language is somewhat similar.
Poe is P-W-O.
That's right.
And yours is...
P-A-O.
Okay.
In other words, it's a two-syllable word, right. You see. If I just put it P-A-O, people would think it's Pow, they try to say, you know.
Just like Batman.
And the Pole were happy to see me. And Marion arrived in Madras after going again on she rode on a steamer called the Marine Adder, and it had no guardrails because it was a landing craft type of steamer, you know, built by our good friend Kaiser, all metal. It was really a hot box when they had to go through the hot climate, you know. Well, again, they wove from San Francisco. It was about a 5.5-week trip to Madras. I didn't get into Rangoon at all. Well, I went over to meet them there. I got on one of the smaller ships that ply between Rangoon and Madras and went over and met them there and then brought them back. And we drove up in the weapons carry up to Town G, where we got settled in this house that I had prepared for them. Just 3 months later, I was ordained in Burma by the Baos, the Shans, the Burmese, and a group of missionaries. Believe it or not, I had to answer my ordination questions in three languages. But I felt that since Marion and I had both committed ourselves to a lifetime of service, God willing, with the Bo people, that they should have the right to ordain me. But I was the first missionary to be ordained on the field of Burma. So many missionaries are ordained so quickly after they graduate from seminary. But I didn't feel that I wanted to be ordained at that time. I felt I was going to serve these people. Why shouldn't they choose me? Why shouldn't they ask asked me questions. Well, I got Gus Sword, who was then the field secretary, he came up and he put me over the coals about my theology, you know. And then a lot of the indigenous people that were good, sound, conservative, evangelical, Baptist, you know. So I don't think I got by easily. two boys were ordained at the same time as I was. So there were three of us. What is more to say about it? We moved, while I was here in the United States, I had studied the work of missionaries in Costa Rica and Puerto Rico and Mexico. At that time, there was a concept. Now, these were revolutionary Mexicans, but they had decided that the school, not the church, the school should be the house of the people. They even called it that, Casa el Pueblo, which means the house of the people. And I thought that concept was good for the church. Why shouldn't the church be the center of community activity? And so as I mull this over, and then saw some of the work done in Central America later, we founded what we call the Rural Christian Center. And we started that in about January of 1948. And we moved out there by May or June.
Okay, you set up the Rural Life Center.
Is that yes, Rural Christian Center, we called it. The Po'o Rural Christian Center. And the whole idea of approaching...
Where was that?
It was just 6 miles south of Town G, which was... We were assigned to Town G, you see, but we were working with rural people. I'd say at the time we were there, 95% of the people who were Po'os were rural people, villagers. And living in a big house in the city didn't make sense. They wouldn't come in. They were scared of us to come into the house. And so we moved out there. We built a house very similar to the ones they were living in, with mat walls. It did have a good roof, and we did have windows with little bits, panes of glass, the top in it. That was another way of teaching them, was to say, your houses are too closed, and you must open them a little bit. And we had these door-like windows, you know, double-door windows, and a little bit of pane of glass up the top, so it was light inside.
Well, were their houses just without windows?
Without windows, and just a door, one door, and the smoke would just fill the whole house at times.
Were there a lot of lung diseases?
Well, they weren't. They were outdoors much of the time. They didn't seem to have much disease because of it, but we thought they... And it's very interesting, you know, our house became a model for many, many of them.
Oh, yes.
They liked it. See, in their beliefs, doors were and windows were entryways for the spirits. And therefore, at night particularly, well, you know, we had this belief in what's called miasma or something like that.
Well, malaria, we called it.
Yeah, all right.
Bad air coming in.
Yeah, all right. Anyway... they had that belief, so they kept everything tightly closed. And the smoke just kind of found its way out through the cracks, sort of thing. And we wanted to get them away from that. So we taught them also to build a cookhouse separate. Their cook's fire had been right in the middle of the house. They had both light and heat and cooking fire, you see. We said, well, that's not good for you. And after a period of time, they began building their houses more like ours. Anyway, the whole idea of the Rural Christian Center We had a wonderful hill just north of the northern end of the property that I was given. We had to get the local prince, the native prince, the Saulbois, to come and measure out a certain bit of ground. Now, it had to be ground that was not being used by the local villagers. The reason being is that they have no ownership rights there in that part of Burma, but they have use rights. If you continue to use it, you can hang on to it for generations. But as soon as you let it go for 3 years, then it goes back to the center authority. Well, there was this row of little hillocks along there that nobody had ever used except for one small village plot. And we had to buy that fellow out, buy his rights out, you see.
Yeah.
But he wasn't difficult. I think I paid something like $30 for his rights. And then we had a 26-acre plot. And at the north end was the highest part, and we built our church. And it was not a church, it was a tabernacle. Poles and mat walls and high ceilings holding something between 600 and 700 people. Now, we didn't have a church yet. But I saw this as, if you're going to call the place a meeting place for the people, you got to have a place to take them in, you know. And we built this place, and then I had the bright idea of putting all the walls on hinges. And we just shot a bolt to keep them closed, but when we wanted to, we pulled the bolt out, and then we'd prop these so that we extended that 700 or so to almost 1,500 people that we could entertain. And believe me, we had them a lot of times. We had a lot of people who'd never come, who would come, and they would stay on the outside. They wouldn't get inside, but stay on the outside, under the shade of the... they were a little bit leery of coming into a Christian building, you know. Well, this was all a part of having to break down what they thought. Next to that was our house, and it was, as I say, on a pattern very much like theirs, only much improved. Same materials, but much improved in terms of light and doors and so forth. Then next to that, I had this agricultural development where I hatched baby chicks and raised chickens and pigs and vegetables, and tried to introduce them to the people to raise their standards of living.
Now, when you were telling us about your education, you didn't say anything about agriculture as part of your...
But Cornell's an ag school, you know.
I knew that, but I didn't...
And I took a one general course of a whole year in ag, 6 weeks of market gardening, 6 weeks of poultry, 6 weeks of vegetables, 6 weeks of instruction on fruit crops, through a period of 6 weeks of management. We had a 9 months period, you see. We could get through six subjects that way. And then they gave us a lot of material, like agricultural bulletins and so forth. So if you were smart enough, you could read them and get a lot of it, you know. Anyway, I felt that working with rural people, I needed to be able to demonstrate that I, too, was a farmer. I'd never been one before. But when you meet strange people, what are you going to talk about? And the thing that I found was most easy to start about was the pigs and chickens that were outside the house. Now, that's just a way of getting into people's consciousness, you know. And so we had this very good demonstration farm. And we raised field crops, too, like corn, burpee. You remember burpee seeds?
Yeah. They're still around.
Yeah, well, the old man burpee I met in one of my contacts here in the United States. And I thought, well, now here's a guy that ships hundreds of thousands of pounds of seed to people all over the world. Why shouldn't he ship me some? So I confronted the old man. He was a Baptist, you know.
didn't know that.
Yeah, he was. And I confronted him. I said, now look, I'm doing this kind of work, and my people can't afford to pay for seeds. But why don't you send me some? And for the next 10 years, he kept sending me seeds. And what I did was to get, I'd study, he'd send me his catalog, and I'd study his catalog carefully and try to figure out which ones would meet the needs of the people there. And it's surprising, it's not too difficult if you know anything about growing things. I mean, how much water they need, how long, excuse me, how long they have to be in the ground, how much sunlight they need, all of these things can, the catalogs will tell you. And so I would take the ones and say, well, now, well, I'm going to grow this stuff now, and the conditions are like this. These particular varieties will do better in Burma than others. And I'd ask him to send them to me, and then we'd try them out and try to pick the one or two which are the best. Well, I can tell you that if you go back to Town G now, I can point out to you that about 75% of the vegetables in that big market, and it's a big one nowadays, are progeny from these that I introduced. They had all of them, but they were all poor varieties, you know, and they didn't know how to improve the varieties. Now, of course, Burbank and others have improved varieties on so many vegetables, and they could all see my vegetables. Tomatoes, you know, half pound a piece, some of them, and not stringy, or, you know, it wasn't from age they got big. It was from just rapid growth.
So you weren't changing their basic eating habits, you were just
augmenting them. Yeah. And a few things were new that we introduced, and not all of them took, but nevertheless, at least a dozen vegetables we worked on that way. And they really took, most of them really took. Same with chickens and pigs. Before I left Burma, I was taking pigs by air all over Burma, a pair of pigs to start a new project, you know.
Was heifer project of any help to you in getting them?
No, they never came to Burma. I don't know why. But anyway, that was one thing. Then, a little further down the ridge, was a dispensary. Now, we didn't have a doctor in that area, but there was a fine Christian doctor who was a shaman in the city, Town G. And then we had one of Seagrave's nurses. Now, this is very interesting. She had been his operating nurse when he was operating on the front for the Chinese. And she came and worked with me for 5-6 years. And she was smart as all get out. She was far and away above most nurses. She knew she'd been in the operating room, you know, and Seagrave was one who kind of did the operation and said to the nurse, well, sew it up, you know, and so she was really knowledgeable. Anyway, we had a dispensary with 8 beds in it, and we had hundreds of people coming in, because there was no dispensary except in town, and they were, like everything else, they were scared to go to the government buildings in town. And then the other was a school, which eventually we started as a four-grade school, and eventually it went up to the 7th grade, and that meant they were ready then to go into high school in town. And those kids walked for miles, some of them as many as 6 miles coming and 6 miles returning, because this is the place where there was a school. Well, the purpose of the center was to win people or pull them in so that we could talk to them. And this meant that the dispensary did it, the school did it, the agriculture project did it too. So that when we sent out an invitation for a religious gathering, and we didn't do it too often, but 3 or 4 times a year, we would send out invitations to the head of each village within a scope of 7 miles, let's say. Well, that was 11 villages. And when we sent those out, we would have anywhere from 1,000 to 1,500 people who would come for a whole day. They'd leave early in the morning after they had eaten the rice. They eat rice early there. That's their morning meal. It's usually around 7 o'clock because they have to go to the